सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति 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 अचतुर्वदनो ब्रह्मा द्विबाहुरपरो हरिः अपाललोचनशम्भुः भगवान् बादरायणः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्. ऑन दि ऑस्पिशियस ओकेशन ऑफ गुरु पूर्णिमा वी सल्यूट द ग्रेट सेजेस एंड सेंट्स ऑफ दिस कंट्री हू हैव केप्ट दिस नॉलेज अलाइव फॉर अस through unbroken chain of Guru Parampara. We really do not know when this Parampara started. That is why in every Parampara they trace it finally back to the Lord. They say Lord Narayana or Lord Shiva is the starting point. As such, it's a unknown factor that when it started. It is as old as whatever you can conceive of. This salutations to Guru, though it is very much evident and understandable in spiritual field, particularly in Vedanta, it is applicable in this country for each and every aspect of our lives. We have a Guru Parampara, you will find in music or in dance, any art form for that matter, they talk of a Guru Parampara and there is a lot of weightage given to the Gurus. And worshipping of Gurus is considered the primary duty for everyone. Just as we have a reverence for our forefathers and there is a lineage there who have given us physical birth, the Guru Parampara has given us birth at the spiritual and intellectual level. So there is a lot more allegiance to the Rishi Parampara, the Guru Parampara. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna quotes various references, and humility of Lord Krishna is that he says that he has heard it from the Rishis of the past, Iti Shushruma. Or they prahuhu, they say they have said like this. So nothing is being arrogated to oneself. And the source of all wisdom that he quotes, which is the Upanishads, when we go there, we find brilliant original ideas given there. But the sages or rishis of Upanishads attribute it to their gurus. Iti shushruma purvesham yenastad vichachakshire. Thus have we heard it from our gurus. And thus have we heard it from our gurus. This is not a mere show of humility, they mean it as a matter of fact also. So we do not know when it all started, but through an unbroken chain this has been maintained asmad acharya paryantam, till our guru it is maintained. So we owe an allegiance to the entire parampara starting from our guru. Now the subject for today is Vedantic Theory of Perception. This was delivered by Swami Rama Tirtha one of the stalwarts of Vedanta philosophy in the modern age in 1903 in San Francisco. It is with Swami Rama Tirtha's grace and blessings that we enter the subject today. The term Vedantic Theory of Perception first requires some explanation. There are three terms here: Vedanta, Theory and Perception. We will take it from the reverse. What is perception? Perception is usually associated with sight, vision. But technically, perception is not confined to sight. Perception is with reference to all the five sensory perceptions. The eyes see, ears hear, tongue experiences taste, skin feels touch, and nose smells. These are the five senses that everybody has, and these are the senses through which we contact the world. That is why in Sanskrit they are called as jnanendriyas. Jnanendriya means organs of knowledge. Indriya of knowledge. What knowledge? The worldly knowledge comes to you through these five senses. So the perception actually refers to all these five senses, sensory perceptions. Next is theory. What is theory? Theory is slightly different from law. Law and theory both are scientific in their outlook and approach. The science behind it is that you collect data, you study them carefully, you analyze the data, try to arrive at certain conclusions. If these conclusions are repetitive in nature and you can verify them, then you declare them as law. When you collect the data and try to arrive at an intelligent conclusion which cannot be proved empirically, then it is called as a theory. I repeat, law is something verifiable and provable. You can experiment with it every time and find it working. But theory, though it is scientific in its outlook, you may not be able to conclusively prove it. For example, a couple of years back we had this talk on law of karma. Law of karma is based on the law of cause and effect. For every cause there is an effect, and for every effect there is a cause. Law of karma or law of causation forms the basis of all scientific laws. We say law of gravity. Law of gravity is a law. It can be proved that any object is attracted towards the center of earth at 9.8 meter per second square is a law. You cannot change it and it is verifiable easily. Similarly, there are various other laws in chemistry, in mathematics, in psychology. In Vedanta also we talk about law of neutralization. How a person gets neutralized by constantly contacting a sense object. It's a law. You can verify it. It works every time. Law of love and attachment. These are all laws. But when we extend the law of karma to understand birth and death and what is beyond, we use the term called theory of reincarnation. Reincarnation, the Hindus, Buddhists and these people, they believe in reincarnation. Reincarnation means a man's journey is not going to end by death. There will be further continuation of the journey. He will be born again. But this is a theory. Why is this a theory? Because this cannot be conclusively proved. What happens after death? Nobody knows. Where he goes, nobody knows. We only see that the body is here. It may be burnt or buried. But somebody who was there within the body, what happens to him? Where is he going? Is he being born again? So the rishis of the past again took data, audited it and came to a conclusion that all the forces and energies cannot go into vacant air. They will be born, reborn somewhere. This they found out by auditing both sides of the accounts. Birth and death they audited. Since it cannot be conclusively proven, they called it theory of reincarnation. And corroborative evidences in the form of statements are given in texts like Bhagavad Gita. So from which we can arrive at a certain reasonable conclusion that there could be a life after death. But still, can anybody 100% prove it? Nobody knows. Nobody can prove. So it is called as theory of reincarnation. So the topic today is theory of perception. Perception of each and every person is also a theory. In other words, what you perceive may not be the same as what others perceive, and what you perceive is true for you maybe, it need not be the same for others, which you cannot prove to others. What you see cannot be proven to others. Similarly, what others see, they cannot prove it to you. It is each and every person's perception accordingly. So it is called as theory of perception. And finally, Vedanta. Vedanta refers to Upanishads. Veda plus Anta is Vedanta. Anta is the end portion. Veda refers to the great texts of Vedas. The Vedic texts are voluminous and they contain various mantras, brahmanas, which tells us how to do rituals, etc. Then comes the subjective worship of Aranyakas. But the end of it all is called as Upanishads. Upanishads form maybe a small portion, but they form the most important aspect of Vedas. So it is called as Vedanta. End portion is called Vedanta. What does this Upanishad deal with? Upanishad deals with the Supreme God Brahman. It is also called as Atman. It points out to that only. From various angles, various Upanishads say. Even just before the lecture, we had the Upanishad chanting here. We had the Keno Upanishad, we had the Ishavasya Upanishad, etc. All the theme of all the Upanishads is one and the same, but the angle with which they see is different. So the theme is the same. Now Upanishads not just point out the ultimate reality, they also in the process deal with various other aspects. Like they deal with the world, how it is created, etc. And what is this individual? What is his role in the world? And how he must lead his path. So path is also given. So Upanishad that way is a complete manual for a human being to lead his life. It just does not show the ultimate aim only. It also shows how to lead the path towards that ultimate aim. So this is the aspect of Vedanta. Now this Vedanta is not just confined to Upanishads. Based on the source of Upanishads, various other texts have also been written, and till today it continues to be written. There are Brahma Sutra authored by Vedavyasa himself, and then you have Yoga Vashishta. Those who remember in this auditorium a few months back, a Swami spoke on Yoga Vashishta, which is the inspiration of Swami Rama Tirtha also. It's a fantastic book on Vedanta. Like Bhagavad Gita, various books are there. And similarly, various masters have come. They have also established various schools of thought within Vedanta itself. The basic parameters or the basic building blocks will not change. But there can be slight differences with reference to the final reality or something, or how each and everyone perceives. So even in Vedanta, most people will be aware of the terms like Advaita Vedanta or Vishishta Advaita Vedanta, Dvaita Vedanta, Bhakti Vedanta. Various schools of thoughts are like that. Not just that, in Vedanta, many people, many rishis have also formulated various theories with reference to perception itself. How this world is created, who is the cause for it, how does each and everyone perceive it. If we go into the names of it and if we go into the explanation of it, probably it will be too complicated and confusing. There is something known as Drishti Srishti Vada. Drishti Srishti Vada means first your perception comes, then the creation comes. There is a Vada, means there is an argument. There is another argument which is just the opposite, which says Srishti Drishti Vada. First the creation comes, then you perceive it. This one. Then there is a Ajati Vada, which is theory of non-creation. Like that, various things are there. And if we go into the details of it, as I said, it will be too complicating for us to understand. Fortunately for us, Swami Rama Tirtha has reconciled them all into a very grand understanding. One of the outstanding contributions of Rama Tirtha is to bring it all in a synthetic way and put it in a very scientific way that you cannot miss it. It's an outstanding contribution by Swami Rama Tirtha. In fact, for those who know and follow Swamiji, you will find that most of his books, particularly Vedanta treatise, is inspired by works of Swami Rama Tirtha. A bulk of it you will find it there. Now we come to the subject. What exactly is the nature of this world? This world is known to us, as I said in the beginning, by our sensory perceptions. Cut off your senses, there is no world. A person who is sometimes in hospital in coma, he doesn't experience any world. He may be living for all medical purposes, but he doesn't have any experience of the world because all his five senses are not working. So we know the existence of the world only through our senses. Now the question arises, whose senses is the standard? Different creatures have different senses, isn't it? For fish, everything is very clear under the water. The fish may not know anything existing apart from the water. It does not know a world beyond the ocean or beyond the river. It does not know. For a frog, it can be sometimes inside the water or outside. For a bird, it is a different perception. You have even microorganisms, or even if you discount that, ants are there. Ants have a different perception. Ants also have their senses. Elephants have their senses. Elephant may view everything in a very big way. Ants may view everything in a very small way according to their senses, and for them the things that we see may not exist. It's just a matter of dust for them. So on what basis we say which is the standard perception, which is the standard of the world? Do we go by majority? Majority means humans is out of question. The animals, birds and plants, they are much more there. Or do we go by evolution? We say that humans are the highest evolved creatures, so our perception is the standard. Fine, even among humans, is there a uniform perception? No. Even in humans, there's a continuous evolution. Who is the standard? So, let us say each and every person's view is different. A Hindu view of life is to see everything divine. Isn't it? When you see a stone in a temple, it is not a stone, it is a murti, it is called. It is God. Even by mistake, you stamp on a piece of paper, if somebody does like this. Why? It is Saraswati, it is not paper. For one view of viewing the river is Gangaji. The Gangaji is Ganga Mata also. They have a perception like that. They treat as very holy, sacred. But another way of looking at it is Ganges. Then it is a river for playing, fun. The view or perception of the same thing by different persons are different. So even amongst humans, whose perception is the standard? Can we have that slide? This card was sent to you, right? Now, just for my curiosity's sake, this is a picture of, it's written here, you know, it is. Is it a duck or is it a rabbit? For my sake, if anybody has seen this picture before, because it is not as famous as the picture of an old lady and young lady in the same photograph. You might have known that. In one angle, if you see, it's a young lady. In another angle, it's an old lady. There's a picture. This may not be as famous as that, but it is also you will find it on the internet. It's called the duck rabbit illusion. How many of you knew of this picture before you saw the card? Okay, very few. Others, what did you see first? How many saw duck first? Many have seen only duck. How many saw rabbit first actually? Very few, right? But people have seen. Now, how many of you understood that it can be viewed both ways without the help of others? See, that's very few. Now, the question is this actually a duck which looks like a rabbit? Or is it a rabbit which looks like a duck? Nobody can answer. Who can answer? one who created, not even the designer, he won't know. One who created it will only know that what it is. Now, remember this, if for people who saw only one of this, let us say they saw only the duck, if it was not pointed out by others, would you have seen the rabbit? Sometimes. That means it will strike you. See, suddenly sometimes you throw the card like this and it turns and goes the other side. And when you see the other side, what is this? Suddenly something may strike you. For some, even after others say see a rabbit, means they say where, no. They can't see a rabbit even after say, then you say, oh, that side is the nose and this is the horn or the ears. Then you see that it is a rabbit. Now, this is just to show that anything can be viewed by any angle and it all depends on each and every person's perception. Okay. Now, the question genuinely that may come to people is, why do you just complicate issues with such theories? What is the use? We want something practical, actually. If there is a talk or if there is a lecture or some knowledge on, let us say, how to maintain harmonious relationship in life, marital harmony, that is useful. How to mold the children, or if for the youth, if we take a talk on how to concentrate in examination or during examination time, how to face interview, how to face group discussion, that is more useful. Or even if you have a seminar on stress management, time management, we can see the practical use of it. Not just that, even in spirituality, they talk about very practical techniques, like if there is probably, if we had held a yoga or a meditation session here, when we say that there will be instant relief or result after that, there you will find definitely a lot of people, because it's a very practical technique. Reiki, pranic healing, various things are there. I am not saying that these don't have a value, they do have a value. But why do you complicate with such theories? Who created the world? What is there any use in knowing whether who created the world, whether what is the perception, nature of perception, sensory? All that is theoretical. We dismiss it as theory, not useful. But it is not so. Remember, even for you to sustain a particular practice on a long-term basis, there must be a deep-rooted thought within you which is prompting it. And that thought can be deep-rooted within you only when you work on it on a sustained basis. And working on it on a sustained basis will come only when you are standing firm on the theory behind it. A person who is put a thought is put into him time and again that thought only crystallizes within him over a period of time, and then that gets converted into practice. In chemistry, we read certain theory in the classroom, then you apply it practically in the laboratory, isn't it? Like that, say, let us say a person is there, he is, okay, by nature a thief, he keeps on hearing about a particular neighbor who has a lot of wealth, who may be not that careful or something, so he knows. So he is constantly hearing about that again and again and again. Then it forms a strong thought within him. Later point of time, he may venture into actually breaking his house and robbing the money. So what is deep theory inside will actually convert into practice. The aim that we have of Vedantic Theory of Perception today is not to develop arguments on both sides and finally, get more confused and complicated. Of course, the subject is stirs, it is subtle, that is different. But what is the aim of Vedantic Theory of Perception? Is to understand the reality behind the perception. And then, ultimately, we have to raise the level of our perception. That is the aim. We said that the perception itself is evolving. The present level of perception with which we see the world, how do we raise it? How do we raise it? That is the aim of this Vedantic Theory of Perception. Before we enter into the subject, there are two terms that you need to remember, because this will be constantly used. For any experience, for any perception, there are two aspects. The two aspects are subject and the object. In the one side is the subject. Subject is the person who is experiencing, who is perceiving. He is also called as knower, one who knows, or he is called as an experiencer, he is called as a perceiver, he is called as drashta. In Sanskrit you can use the term drashta. Drashta means one who sees. In effect it refers to the individual. So individual is the subject on one side of perception. On the other side of perception we have the object. Object is that which is known. Object is that which is experienced. In Sanskrit you call it drishya. So you can remember these two terms, drashta and drishya. Drashta and drishya are the two aspects of perception. And then what you finally know as the object can be covered in one word called world. What you experience is your world. So individual and the world form the two parts of perception. In this itself there is a little difference in understanding as far as Western philosophers are concerned and Vedanta is concerned. In West, the mind is taken to be the subject. In West, the mind and intellect, your thoughts, that is taken to be the subject. But Vedanta does not accept mind to be the subject. The reason is that the real knower cannot be known. I repeat, the real knower cannot be known. But the fact is that we know our mind. We can formulate the laws of our mind. To the extent that we know our mind, mind cannot be the real subject. So as far as Vedanta is concerned, Atman is the real subject. Atman is the real subject with mind as its agent. I repeat, in the West, mind is the subject. In Vedanta, Atman is the real subject with mind as its agent. What you experience is the object. There's no difference. Now, in the West, they formulated various theories to understand how the world is created, how we perceive it. Again, why we are using these theories of the West and not the old Vedantic theories is that in the 19th century when Swami Rama Tirtha was there and Swami Vivekananda were there, there was a lot of thinking happening in the West. Even in West there were older theories, but lot of thinking happening in the West. So very many philosophers came with divergent views. These divergent views were formulated under two broad categories. One is called as idealism, another is called as realism. Again, we will not go into the full details of it, but a study of these two in a very simple term is useful in understanding Vedantic theory of perception. That's how Swami Rama Tirtha reconciles. So there are two schools of thought. One is called as idealism, another is called as realism. In a general definition term, idealism considers the world that we see, the world that we perceive as it is false. It is not there. It is nothing is there. Everything is projected by your mind only. This is their contention. Realist is just the opposite. They say what you perceive in the world is real. As it is. World as you see is real, very much real. So don't dismiss the world. This is the basic contention of realist. Basic contention of idealist is that your mind alone is real, it projects everything. Basic contention of realist is that world is real, it is nothing to do with your projection or anything. This is the basic point. First, we'll get into idealism. In idealism, for those who are interested, great philosophers like George Berkeley, Plato, Kant, Hegel, these are the philosophers who are proponents of or supporters of the theory called idealism. What idealists say is that world is a projection of your thoughts. No perception in this world is possible without the participation of your mind, right? See, for example, when your mind is absorbed in reading something, you are too much involved with that reading of a book or a novel. Somebody enters your house, you are not aware. A cat enters and goes to the kitchen and does something, you are not knowing what is happening. It's not just books. Sometimes IPL cricket is going on. You are so engrossed in viewing the match, you are totally into it. Okay? So what is happening in the house around, nobody knows. So therefore they say, for any activity or any experience to be there, It is possible only when the mind is there. So when the mind is not there, don't assume it is happening. It is not there. When people sleep, their eyes are open. Some people have that, like fish. Now objects may move in front of the eyes. Light may be there. Sometimes people may even touch you while sleeping. They are shaking. That person has no receptivity at all. He doesn't see anything. He doesn't feel anything. Why? Because idealists say mind is not there. When mind is not there, none of the experience is there. What happens in deep sleep? Deep sleep is a state called sushupti, where there is no dream. When there is no dream and you are sleeping peacefully, where is the world? What do you say in deep sleep? When you get up from deep sleep, you say, it was wonderful. What was wonderful? Describe that wonderful. It was so nice. It was so nice only you can say. What was so nice? I saw nothing. So nothingness. Nothingness is the state of deep sleep. Nothingness is there because there is no mind. So when there is no mind, there is no world as experienced in our deep sleep. This is their contention. You also know there is something called as hypnotism. A person who is a hypnotist, he brings the other person under his control and then suggests to his mind that the floor that you are all sitting on the floor. Floor means there is a floor beneath your legs. The floor that you are sitting is not a floor but a lake. And then that man believes it is a lake. And then he goes fishing in it. This happens. In hypnotism, a man's mind can be hypnotized to believe that what you see as floor is actually, he is seeing it as a lake. So therefore, they say, where is the lake? The lake is nowhere else. It's in his mind only. So each and everything is created by the mind only. People see ghosts. Isn't it? There are people who have experienced ghosts. But is ghost really there? It's all in his mind, they say. There was a in Punjab, there was a burial ground where there was cemetery, and they were talking about the movement of some ghosts there. So one boy was a braggart. He said, there's no such thing as ghost. He said, it is, others are saying, no, it is there. He said, I challenge you, there's no ghost. What do you want me to do? In the middle of a night, on Amavasya day, when there's no moon, you go there and you nail in one of the coffins or whatever you call it, there, you know, there's a platform. So there you have to nail it, hammer a nail and come, they say. He accepts the challenge and he says, okay. But on that particular day, he's feeling little afraid. But still he has admitted he is a braggart, so he goes there. In the night when he goes there, it is dark, and as in the movies they show, the leaves are rustling and certain sounds are coming. He is feeling more afraid. But since he has come fully, he wants to finish the job. In the fear, he goes there and he is sweating now. And in the process of driving the nail into the coffin or something there, you know, like a kurta, if it is worn here, his kurta falls on the platform. He keeps the nail, he doesn't know what it is, he keeps the nail on it and he drives the nail inside. And he wants to quickly do it and return. So he quickly nails it and he is about to turn. The portion of the cloth that is caught in it is not allowing him to turn. Then he is now convinced, he shouts ghost and he falls unconscious. This is a story. Now tell, where was the ghost? The ghost was within him or was he really seeing a ghost? So the idealists say, there is no such thing as ghost, it is only your mind that is projecting. There are certain people on the positive side see Lord, they have darshan. Some people have seen, even devotees have seen Krishna. They see the vision of the Lord, etc. Is that for real or is it their mind's projection? Idealists say it is their mind projection only. This is the first argument of idealists, that everything in the world is possible by the activation of your thoughts only. The second argument of idealists is that if the perception of the world is based on your senses, whose senses has to be taken as standard? That's what we began the lecture. Whose perception is taken to be a standard? You know, what you see as flower, that flower may have a red color or yellow color, but who deals with that flower on a daily basis is a bee. Now, thank God we have science, advanced science, which shows documentary, etc. The bee does not view the flower in the same way as you and I perceive. The bee views it in somewhat ultraviolet, something is there. Its perception is smell, connected with smell more, but what it sees of the flower is different. A dolphin is able to have X-ray vision and see through the body. They experimented with a pregnant lady and it was able to see. That's why it was able to help her get out of the water. It was just an experiment. But the point is, a fish perception, a dolphin's perception is different. So whose perception you will take it as standard? Even if you take your own perception, we hear certain sound. Science says that we can hear from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. This is the range of human hearing. But bats hear something different, isn't it? Mosquitoes hear something different. That's why certain repellents are producing certain sound. You can't hear the sound. The mosquitoes hear it and they get irritated by it. Whether it is effective or not, I don't know. But this is the principle in which it works. The principle is that the mosquito hears something else. You hear something else. Bats hear something else. If you adjust your ear bones and the receptive cells in your eyes in a different way, you will see the world entirely different. There was a person in America, it actually happened. He met with an accident. He fell down. There was some injury here in the ear. But then he got all right. But from that day onwards, he was hearing some music all the time. 24 hours, some music was going on. People around him were very much convinced that it was some psychological problem only, because his body otherwise was very perfect. Pressure, sugar, nothing was, no test was not revealing anything. But a week or so, continuously he was saying, I am listening to the music you are saying. Then they needed to find out what it was. Then they asked what type of music. They asked him to go along with the music. Then they found out the music was running in a FM radio station nearby. That FM radio, he was directly listening with. We hear with the radio, right? What happened in that accident was, certain bones in his ear got adjusted in a different way. He was beginning to hear something that we don't hear. Then they rectified it. But it is possible. The point is, if it is adjusted in certain way, if your eyes are now in certain way, if the lenses of the eyes are adjusted according to a telescope, you will see the sun and moon clearly. You will not see the bus coming, but in the other road. That's why somebody has designed it in a nice way. If the eyes are, lenses are designed in a way of a microscope, you will see very clearly on your skin itself, there are a lot more microbes and other things. But you will not see anything else. The television you can't see. It will be very blurred. Haven't you seen under microscope also? You need a special vision to see it. So, what the idealists are saying is that your senses cannot be taken as the standard. Whose senses can be taken as the standard? So it is all in your mind only. So what they do is, idealists lionize the subject. They say subject is everything. Nothing they give to the object. They say it is only subject. There is nothing apart from the subject. It is the mind that creates everything. This is the side of idealists. Now come to the realists. Realists are saying, the great philosophers who supported realism are Bain, Mill, for those who are interested. Realists are saying, be practical. World as you see is real in themselves. It's a totally the opposite stance of the idealists. What you see as world is real in itself. World has been there always. Your father, your forefathers, everybody went to Ganges, took bath, and they are doing certain rituals there. You are also doing, your son will be doing later on. Ganges doesn't change. It has nothing to do with projection or anything. Because Ganga is always running. Himalayas is always there. World is always there. Everything is always there. There is not just you. Everybody sees the same way. Everybody sees the moon only. Nobody suddenly sees and says there is sun there. Everybody sees it in the same way. So therefore, each and every person has an experience which is very real, they are saying. You experience pain, that is real. See, the contention of realists is that your thoughts are insubstantial. This is the second argument. One thing is that it is there, they're always there, saying world is there always. The contention of the realist is there. Your thoughts are insubstantial. Can anybody see the mind? Can anybody see the thoughts? Can you touch it? You cannot. The insubstantial thoughts cannot produce substantial world. I repeat, insubstantial, the solid world is there. Solid world cannot be produced by insubstantial thoughts. If that is so, if you can, then they are realists are challenging. If everything is your thought, then you know, you take a handkerchief and try to make a lion out of it. It's a, you are saying everything is thought, right? Then where there is a wall, you see Ganga there. You try to see. They say it is all just not possible. What you are talking is absolutely not possible. They are very clear that wall is there. Wall is there, you bang your head against the wall. And you say it is all thoughts. Your pain will be there. That pain is very much real. If everything is thoughts, they are right. Realists are saying very, very simple challenge they are giving. Everything is thoughts, right? Everybody feels hunger. When you are feeling hunger, just think of the food and you feel satisfied. Ah, nice. Nice meal I had and you feel satisfied. It must be satisfied. That doesn't happen. Your hunger is real. The food that you eat is real. If you don't have the food, the pain that you experience is real. This is the contention of realists. They are saying, okay, you say there is no mind, there is no world in the deep sleep, right? Think about it. When the alarm clock rings, how do you wake up? Therefore, they say, you may go to sleep, but the world is there. It is there. Alarm clock is functioning, it is working, it is waking you up, it is your own experience. How do you say it is not there? So they are saying that what is being seen is not a projection, what is being seen, what is being experienced is there, it is always there. In the process, realists lionize the object, just as idealists lionize the subject. They say subject is everything, there is nothing apart from the subject. Realists are saying objects is everything, objects is there, whether you understand it or not, that's a different thing, but it is there. This is the contention of realists. There are certain rejandites also. Now, idealists are saying, you say the pain is real? If the pain is real, haven't you even seen in your own experience? You are engrossed in playing cricket. Sometimes you get hurt. You don't even realize the pain. You don't even realize, you continue playing. There was our Parama Guru Swami Chinmayananda. Most of you would have heard him. Certain lectures and his lecture schedules were very packed and very continuous. Some points of time, he used to run even high fever or temperature where the body is not able to fully cooperate. But once the commitment for lecture is there and he comes and sits on the seat, he lectures with such full vigor and enthusiasm that you will not believe that he is suffering from fever. After the lecture is over, they will carry him and give him medicines and take him to the doctor. To that extent, he is actually affected. But what happens to the pain and fever during the lecture? It is not there. There was a great musician in South India called Madurai Mani Iyer. He was a doyen of Carnatic music. He was a great stalwart. During the last years of his life, he had contracted a disease which was very critical. But still, because of people's request, they used to organize his concert, music concert. They used to bring him and put him on the stage. He might not even know who the accompanists are. But once the concert begins, it goes on for full flow for few hours, non-stop. Where does that energy come? What happened to all this disease and all that he is suffering from during the concert? So they are saying, idealists are giving to rejoinder, it is not so. You don't say that the pain is real. Only if you think of pain, the pain is there. Only if you think of pain, the pain is there. And it is a matter of time before you produce anything. You keep on trying to look at it in a certain way, you will start looking at it in a certain way. This is their contention. You are saying about that everything is real, right? Then how does a hypnotist see a lake where there is a floor? So they are saying everything is a projection of the mind only. Again, realists are giving other rejoinders. Okay, he is fishing, right? The hypnotist, the somebody who is hypnotized is actually fishing. Did he get any fish? Did he get any fish? No. Then they are saying, why do you ask me? Go and ask the person who is fishing, whether he got fish or not. How do you know that he is fishing? There is no end to these arguments. Please remember, the idea of studying and idealism and realism is to understand that this circle of argument will never end. Idealists have their own set of arguments, realists have their own set of arguments, and it becomes too complicated. You do not know which is right or which is wrong. There was a, you know, actually realists are saying to idealists that you are painting a picture of what is known as a, like a Krita Yuga. Krita Yuga is like a utopia. That is why when everything is, you know, in a perfect order, you say it's an ideal world. It's an ideal thing. Everything is ideal. They say Krita Yuga is ideal, but there is no such thing as Krita Yuga. Kali Yuga is real. Kali Yuga, in Krita Yuga, what they say is there need not be any king. There need not be any government. Everybody will follow dharma accordingly. You will not take anything beyond what you want. Enough resources are there. Everybody is happy. All this is fine in a lecture to hear. But in actual practice, it doesn't happen. Reality is Kali Yuga. You better be careful with what you possess and you be safeguarding whatever you have. It is like that. Like that is the argument between idealism and realism. There was a argument between Mr. Wood and Mr. Axe. They were continuously arguing as to who is great. Finally, the axe said, I will chop you to pieces. I will chop you to pieces, he said. For which Mr. Wood said, for that also you need my help only. Because the, you know, the axe is made of a wooden handle, right? So what it means is that the piece of iron in the axe and the wood are interdependent on each other. Both of them have to go together, right? This is the story of the wooden axe. So, in summary, idealism is that school of thought which says thoughts alone are real. Thoughts alone project the world. There is nothing beyond your mind. Realism is that school of thought which says world is real as it is, irrespective of your thought. You may participate in it or not participate in it. They act on
Poornam Adah, Poornam Idam, Poornat, Poornam Udachyate, Poornasya, Poornam Adaya, Poornam Eva Vashishyate. Shanti, shanti, shanti.